We welcome you to this act of worship as we virtually gather together to reflect on God's grace and mercy towards us during these uncertain and difficult times. It is our prayer that today, the sixth Sunday after Epiphany, that you will be richly blessed and inspired to continue to trust, obey, and praise Almighty God through all of these changing scenes of life. Let us therefore bow our heads and hearts as we pray together the Collect for Purity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Holy Lord, everything we need is found in you. For those of us who come today feeling broken, bring restoration. For those of us who are feeling weak, give us your strength. For those who are weeping, bring joy. For those who are filled with doubt, restore our faith. For those who are feeling burdened, give us rest. And for those who are feeling anxious, grant us your peace. Open our hearts to you this day and forevermore. And we ask all these things through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
In the streets of every city. God chose to make known how great among the nations are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia. Blessed Lord and Father, we have assembled in your name and in fellowship with one another. Enable us by your grace to offer the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, to proclaim and respond to your holy word. Teach us to pray for your world and your church. Grant that we, confessing our sins, may worthily offer to you our souls and bodies as a living sacrifice, and eat and drink of your spiritual food in this holy sacrament. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, who before the passion of your only begotten Son revealed his glory upon the holy mountain, grant to us that we, beholding by faith the light of his countenance, may be strengthened to bear our cross and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Word of God, written in 2 Kings chapter 2, beginning to read at the first verse. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other, until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please, let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet, if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elijah kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the Word of God, written in St. Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 4, beginning to read at verse 3. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves. We proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark, the 9th chapter, beginning to read at the 2nd verse. At that time, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up on a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my Son, the Beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the gospel of Christ. I speak to you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Today is the last Sunday after the Epiphany, and our gospel reading tells the story of Jesus' transfiguration on a mountaintop in the presence of his disciples. Inspired by this passage of scripture, late 19th, early 20th century priest in the Anglican Church, Joseph Robinson, wrote these familiar words, "'Tis good, Lord, to be here. Thy glory fills the night. Thy face and garments like the sun shine with unborrowed light. 'Tis good, Lord, to be here, thy beauty to behold, where Moses and Elijah stand, thy messengers of old." It was a unique display of his divine character and a glimpse of the glory which Jesus had before he came to earth in human form. But Christ's glory is not to be proclaimed apart from the cross. Little wonder then that this gospel is used on the Sunday before we begin our journey to Calvary, this Wednesday, Ash Wednesday. Little wonder then that our colleague speaks to it. For the Son of God came to earth in the form of a man to be the true servant of God. This story, like all the stories in the Bible, is important to us because it once again affirms that Jesus is the Son of God. This is the second time that the voice of God attests to the truth of Jesus' sonship. The first time was at his baptism, just before he began his public ministry, when God said then, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." Now he affirms and commands us to listen to him. Listen to Jesus because his words are true. We may not see God's glory the way the apostles did, but I believe that God wants us to experience his glory too. And like the disciples, I believe that when we do, we won't forget the experience. And although we may not experience God's glory as the disciples did on that mountain, through the power of the Holy Spirit, there are still many ways that we can witness, experience, and know the same Lord of glory written about in the Gospels. Through the Eucharist, through prayer and meditation, the hymns and collects, through nature, and by simply reading the Bible, we experience the glory of God, which is not only around us, but also readily available to us. And when God's glory, His presence, His power, His magnificence comes into a life, visits a congregation, meets someone at the altar, or during the singing of a hymn, people know it. Just like the Israelites knew it when they saw Moses' face after he came down from the mountain after having talked with God. While people may respond in different ways, they nonetheless know God Almighty is presence. You see, when you get a glimpse of the glory of God, like Moses, your face will radiate and shine. When you get a glimpse of the glory of God, like Job, you will want to repent in dust and ashes. Or like Isaiah, you will declare, "Here I am, send me." And while most of us may never experience anything close to what Isaiah, Moses, or Peter saw, we have been nonetheless, at some time or another, been so deeply touched and moved by God's Holy Spirit that it causes us to sing. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Oh, wonderful, oh, marvelous is my Savior's love for me. At other times, when we experience His glory, we may feel like being quiet, reflective, meditative, as we think of the goodness of Jesus and what He has done for us. It makes our soul cry out, "Hallelujah! Thank God for saving me." It causes us to think of the many blessings He has bestowed upon us. A good friend, our church, this church to come to on Sundays or any other time for that matter. Health, and oh, how we will not ever, I hope, underestimate that blessing. For as bad as we may feel, we are here this morning. These moments of experiencing God's glory makes us want to stay right where we are and never leave. They also make us want to do something because His presence and His glory empowers us, just as it did Peter, who wanted to build 3 booths. And they make you so weak. Yes, they can make you weak, just like the disciples as they fell back in fear as they recognize this awesome moment. And if we are willing, the same Holy Spirit which overwhelmed and overshadowed Jesus at His transfiguration will similarly overshadow us and fill our hearts and minds with a commitment of love, for it is love which enables us in ministry. For there are people waiting for us when we come down from the mountaintop, moments of glory, church, Sunday by Sunday, or any other moment. There are people waiting for us to minister to them as they were waiting for Jesus. He comes down from the mountaintop and heals a boy who suffered with epilepsy. We aren't to stay on the mountaintop, beautiful though the view may be. We have been called to ministry, to service, to witness, wherever, whenever. I believe that there is a lot of power, great comfort and love in the story of the Transfiguration. For it is a comforting joy to know that God loved us so much that He sent His Son Jesus as a visible, practical example of His glory and to show us what ultimate love is all about. It is a sample of what we may expect when we go to our eternal home to be with Him forever. It is a comforting joy to know that God loves us so much that, like any good parent, He offers advice. This advice: listen to Him. Listen to Jesus. And as we listen, as we follow where He leads, we will find that even as Jesus brought glory to God through obedience, that we will too. We will bring him glory as we submit to him, as we demonstrate the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, self-control, as we rely on him for strength, especially at this time, instead of relying on ourselves by not worrying, knowing that God will take care of us. None of this comes easy, nor does it come naturally. But through faith in Jesus and with the help of the Holy Spirit, the transformation of our lives and the lives of others is possible. And we will indeed be able to do all things to the honor and glory of his name. Then, as the hymn writer says, we will be changed from glory into glory till in heaven we take our place, till we cast our crowns before thee, lost in wonder, love, and praise. I pray that we will always live in the hope and presence of God. And I hope that we will never cease to experience God's amazing love, his power, and his glory. Yes, 'tis good, Lord, to be here. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Intercessory prayer, Form E, in the Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray for the fellowship of the Church of Christ and for all God's creatures. With all who confess the name of Jesus as Lord and Savior, we offer our prayers and praises in spirit and in truth. Father in heaven, hear our prayer. With Jesus Christ, our great high priest, whoever lives to intercede for us, we uphold all ministers of God's word and sacraments, that they may fulfill their high calling in the faith. Father in heaven, hear our prayer. We pray for the unfailing guidance of the Holy Spirit on those who are called to interpret and expound the will of the Lord to others. Father in heaven, hear our prayer. We pray for all organizations within the fellowship of the body of Christ, that their work may edify the people of God and bear faithful witness to the gospel. Father in heaven, hear our prayer. We pray for all persons who do not share our confession of faith, that with courage, truth, and love, we may work together with them and promote the common good. Father in heaven, hear our prayer. For the leaders of our country and all who make decisions on our behalf, that they may be guided by the Spirit to direct our affairs in righteousness and peace. Father in heaven, hear our prayer. For our judges, magistrates, and all who administer justice, and that in all things they may seek to do your will and to protect the rights and freedom of our people. Father in heaven, hear our prayer. In our schools and in all other places of learning, may true knowledge, sound wisdom, and godly discipline ever be found. Father in heaven, hear our prayer. To the poor, the hungry, the unemployed, and all victims of persecution and discrimination of any kind, may God in Christ help us all to bring relief, justice, and protection. Father in heaven, hear our prayer. To all who suffer now from pain and disease, from human discomfort and misery, may God in Christ bring healing and joy for the renewal of their faith. Father in heaven, Hear our prayer. That we may use aright the fullness of the earth, that our pursuits in science and the advancement of our skills may ever be in the service of that true humanity, which is created in the image of God. Father in heaven, hear our prayer. That we may never become the slaves of money or of the lust for power, but may rather strive with victory through the power of love. Father in heaven, hear our prayer. That with all who belong to the communion of saints, both living and departed, we may ever rejoice in the blessed assurance of that hope, which has been won for us in Christ. Father in heaven, receive these our prayers in the name of your dear Son, even Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let's Christ, the Son of God, gladden your hearts with the good news of his kingdom. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.